If you're kind of having some hallway conversations, you can kind of close those down or head to the field.
I thought we're not allowed to go on the field.
Okay. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, not on the field, to the chairs overlooking the field. I figure maybe our very last year we're doing the conference here, we could just all flood the field and be like, peace, we're out. It's like, but we don't want to burn that bridge. So, all right, cool. Well, hey, I'm really excited for this talk. Pete Cheslock has always been, Pete Cheslock has always been really great for us here in Austin for the conference, and I don't even know if you need much of an introduction, so I'll kind of let you just take it away. But
awesome.
But we're stoked you're here, man.
Yeah, I'm glad to be here.
Makes me happy to see you all the time. So
it's awesome.
We had to remove this out of my house, which is weird. So I don't know. I'm gonna have to take it back home.
I'm frightened. It's in such good condition after a few years. I did not actually make a cardboard cutout of myself. A few years ago, I had come to these DevOps days, specifically in Austin. I really like these DevOps days. And I was not able to come. And so my marketing people were like, oh, we'll just send a cardboard cutout of you. And it just kind of blew up. And then I think it ended up going to Chef Conference, which was right after. And then I saw pictures of it crowd surfing. So it turned out everyone liked the flat version of me better than me. So, you know. I was actually surprised they didn't put Pete Flatlock in the other room to give a talk. More people would have gone there. So, anyway, my name is Pete Cheslock. I work in a new company I just started last summer, a company called Chaos Search. We're actually sponsoring, and we're down in the venue, turning Amazon S3 into an Elasticsearch cluster. It's a really cool product. It's a lot of fun. You can find me on Twitter at Pete Cheslock. Mostly just meat tweets are what's on there. I got a smoker, which I feel like is the kind of rite of passage for that like middle-aged dude to get a smoker and smoke meats. So I just tweet pretty much that all the time, and like very occasional technology related. And then I've worked for a bunch of companies you probably haven't heard of before, maybe some that you might have. But for about 20 years, I had been doing technical operations, building large-scale technical teams, as well as SaaS infrastructure or bare metal infrastructure. And I traded in my PagerDuty for a HubSpot account, because now I joined Chaos Search as the VP of product. And I got to do this last summer, which is the most awesome thing to do. God, that thing's scaring the crap out of me. So I got to delete PagerDuty. I love PagerDuty. I love the tool. But I have yet to run into a situation where I've got like a 2 a.m. There's an emergency product call. I need a PowerPoint presentation ASAP. None of that's happened yet. So it's pretty awesome. So what is this talk all about? Well, back in 2013, it was the second DevOps Days Austin, I had submitted my first conference talk ever and my first DevOps Days ever. And I tweeted it out, I was really excited about it, got my one retweet, which I think was from the DevOps Days account. And what I was noticing in conference talks was everyone talked about, like, how do you hire a DevOps, how do you find these people? No one talked about what you did afterwards. How do you keep them happy? And so then I got the email acceptance letter, which I actually had to send a message to Anthony Goddard. I was like, why did you... This guy lives in Boston. He has no affiliation with the Austin community at all, and he sent me the approval that your talk was accepted. So, of course, now in like classic Cheslock fashion, I was freaking out because now I actually had to put the conference talk together. And in normal mode for me is do it the night before, which is exactly what I did. So a lot of times people are like, well, 2013, what is that, 6 years ago? It doesn't feel like a long time. Just how long ago was that? Docker was announced a month prior. Can you imagine a world without Docker? That 5-minute video that Solomon did at PyCon was like a month and a half prior to when I gave that talk. So it feels like a world ago. It was also at the Marchesa? I'm from Boston, so I don't pronounce any words correctly. And I was just in time for the Metaphysical Life Fair. I actually Googled this because I was like, is that a real thing? It's like the longest running psychic conference. It's still happening in Austin, but I guess no longer there. So I did this talk, how to keep the people you need. And what's, I think, most interesting is that I never used the word DevOps here. I talked about system automation, release engineering, operations. At the time, I was very down on the whole DevOps as a job title thing. Now I just don't care. I'm just a product guy, so I don't have to care about any of that stuff anymore. And the other kind of note, I'm going to be calling back on this talk a few places that I think were correct and spot on, a few places where I was totally wrong. But I think what's really cool is the resolution, it's 4x3. Again, just 6 years. but the presentation thing didn't support widescreen format. So some things didn't age so well there. So what are we going to talk about? Over the last few weeks, I've been kind of revisiting the slide deck. I even rewatched the talk, which I hate watching myself talk, much like I'm sure all you do. And just kind of, you know, kind of bumping out all these different little things I was saying at the time. But over this six-year time period, you know, I've interviewed probably a few hundred engineers across three different companies, build out teams, and really just what was wrong, what was right, you know, what can we improve? So I still do want to start with a disclaimer because there is no one way to do this. And my way is based on kind of my personal experience, books that I've read, interactions that I've had. And I've also worked at startups primarily. And so if you're at, you know, a huge 100,000 person enterprise company, how you're going to attract and retain people is going to be a lot different. So maybe 400,000. I don't know how many people are at IBM. Quite a bit. So... And if you're like a sysadmin at a university, you know, again, how you incentivize and keep those people happy in different organizations is totally different. I mean, at a startup, in many ways, I can't even do a 401k match, right? And some people might consider that table stakes. And so there's a lot of variables involved here, so I always like to make that disclaimer. And also, I've been wrong a lot of times. And there was even points where I had so much churn in my engineering organization that I just had to stop because, like, I was doing something wrong. I'm like, am I just a bad manager? Probably. Am I hiring the wrong people? Like, what is going on? Because we were having a really hard time keeping engineers for a while. So one important note that I do want to make is that you can't keep everyone. People are eventually going to leave for one reason or another. Your hope is that you're going to, you know, lose them for a good reason, although it may not feel like a good reason to lose good people. Not all reasons are bad. Maybe the company is shifting. Maybe they want to do something that you can't offer them. Maybe they want to be a manager and you just don't have any manager roles. You know, you obviously want to do your best to try to, you know, keep people and keep them engaged in your company, but it doesn't always work that way. You want to keep them so that they can grow, but you know, people are the largest investment your company likely makes, so just don't waste it. So in the past, I talked about how recruiting, you know, it's really hard when you work for a company that no one's ever heard of before. And it was kind of ironic because when I gave this talk before, I went to work for a company called Dyn, which a lot of people knew about because it was Dyn DNS, and a lot of kind of tech folks used Dyn DNS. But the company before that was a company that no one had ever heard of. It was like an email archiving company. You know, it was strange to say it a little bit because just 6 years ago, there was a very small number of companies that were really doing things like cloud and, you know, all these new infrastructure as code type of things. Puppet, Chef, those were really just starting to get embraced at a lot of companies. So I think name recognition actually was important back then. But nowadays, you know, I just think it's less so. I just don't believe it's the case anymore. Everyone is doing something probably with the cloud or Kubernetes or whatever. How many people are looking at, thinking about, dreaming about Kubernetes in your environment? A whole bunch of people. You know, I always like to say that, you know, you're likely going to, you know, if there's some technology that you want to work on, it's very likely there's a company or all the companies are doing that. Whereas before, I mean, it was like everyone's like, I want to work at Etsy and I want to work at Netflix. And like there was this, you know, name recognition around there. So I think people choose the companies, and again, this is a little bit of my personal opinion, on kind of three very, very simplistic ways to look at it. The team, the technology, and the money. What I think is interesting about these three things, at least in my experience, has been if two of the things are met, then you're probably happy at your company. And I've played around with this a while, right? Like if you have a really good team and really awesome technology, like maybe I don't need, you know, super top tier, you know, money. Maybe like good money with a great team, but you have to write Perl all day, I might do that too. You know, so I think there's some variables here, but I think you got to have at least two of these things to really be happy. Because at the end of the day, these are the things that are going to be the same at every company. Like there's going to be some sort of, especially in the tech world, there's going to be some sort of tech, some sort of team, and they're going to hopefully pay you for that. So has recruiting changed over the past 6 years? Sadly, the bad recruiters are still bad, and I think they've actually gotten worse in many ways. You know, this is a tweet I just saw pretty recently, and it's kind of hard to see, so I'll just read it real quick. So it says, this is like a recruiter that's doing like a mail merge or like automated, you know, kind of junk email. But it says here, the subject line, I have never heard of Google or ClassPass. And then it says, hey, Angela, I've honestly never heard of any of the companies you've worked for or the school you went to, but people tell me they're okay. Angela went to UCLA. I almost didn't write this email because I'm really busy, but I figured why not? Like, whew, that's terrible. So good recruiting, though, is the long game. I have spent years in recruiting. I've been trying to work and recruit Paul for decades now, at least, right? Just for his smoked meats. But, you know, the relationships matter when recruiting. And I remember that there was an engineer that I had been kind of friendly with, and, you know, we kind of rolled in the same circles. When he started telling me, like, oh, I'm not really happy where my, you know, where I'm at with my job, that's when I was able to get in and say, hey, oh, hey, like, here's what we're doing. Any interest in that? And so we, in Boston, we actually started a meetup group. There was kind of a handful of folks. We'd get together for lunch or beers just kind of occasionally. And we just said, you know what, let's just meet in an office and we can all network and we can all just kind of commiserate about computers. And yeah, it's grown to, you know, a few hundred people. If I had more time, I would probably schedule them more often. But it's just a pure networking event. I mean, there's meetups everywhere. But a lot of the meetups are like, go and like, you know, eat some pizza and learn about Kubernetes or learn about Docker. And what I saw was that there just wasn't a meetup that was, I just want to meet other people doing what I'm doing. And people really love it. Now, I get called out all the time. They're like, Boss Ops, it's just Pete's personal recruiting vehicle. And while it totally is, it is also a way we've gotten other people jobs. So people have come to it and just kind of been like, oh, yeah, like, I'm really not enjoying my job. And, of course, like, everyone's like, oh, well, here's what we're doing, here's what we're doing. So so I think when it does come to recruiting, though, the relationships still matter. You know, having these long-term relationships, if you just say to yourself, oh, I need to go get some engineers, like, right now, if you haven't had any of these long-term relationships, like, expect that to take months. You know, like I said, I've started years recruiting engineers beforehand. And those very best engineers, the ones that will never, you'll never get through a recruiter, that you'll never get kind of cold off the street, those engineers, there's a whole back channel that happens when they're looking for a job, you know, when they're thinking about going to something new. And they just, they don't even come on the market. They don't even come close to the market. They have their new job lined up before anyone even knows that they left the old one. You know, but it's harder. Recruiters, I've worked with some recruiters that take the relationship approach, and it is very hard. You know, it's a hard way to do business, and so that's why I think you see a lot of these recruiters just kind of spray and pray. So why did I just kill all this time talking about hiring, because we're supposed to be talking about how to retain people? Well, I think hiring is actually a key part of retention, because not only the right person in the wrong role is probably going to leave, but also the wrong person comes in could totally destroy your organization and your sanity as well. You know, they can cause all of your best engineers to leave. And, you know, people always say, like, the belief of the brilliant asshole, and it's like, no, it's just an asshole. And if you don't act on that right away, even to the detriment of your business, I had worked at a company where it was the brilliant asshole, and he did everything himself, and he would go on these, like, two-week coding binges and, like, deliver software. And he was critical to the business. He was very, very smart. But he was terrible in every imaginable way possible. And even though it was a detriment to the business, we got rid of him, you know, and it was painful, and we all had to work a lot harder for a few months until we picked it up. But it was way better than having to deal with this person anymore. So I keep on saying the right hires a bunch of times. I want to talk about checkbox hires. I've hired so many people in my career that, you know, it's embarrassing to talk about how many times that I've just blindly hired people based on kind of a series of checkboxes. But when you're scaling really fast, you may not have another option. So checkbox hires are, you know, kind of your dream candidate, right? You write up a list of job description. I need, you know, 2 years of Amazon, maybe Ruby experience, Golang preferred, you know, a whole list of stuff. And then you find this candidate comes in and they just check every box, 100% of them, right? And you're thinking to yourself, wow, what a hire, dream hire. They can come in, they can hit the ground running, there's no ramp up time. You know, they know all the technologies that are in your environment. And what I have found is that these engineers, they already know what you have. There's no challenge for them. And they get bored easily. And either what will happen is they start going off on these like engineering boondoggles to try to do something new, because they already know all the stuff you have. Or they just quit, right? And honestly, both of those is a pretty bad situation. So what if instead of hiring for the checkboxes, we hired for a couple of key attributes? One of those is intellectual curiosity and aptitude to learn. And I've realized that at the very crux of hiring people and keeping people motivated, these are the two things that really is the only things that matter. You know, 6 years ago, no one was using Docker. Now a lot of people are. Well, did these people just magically get this Docker knowledge in their head. No, they were curious about what this new technology was, and they had that aptitude to go dive in and learn it. And when it comes to kind of modern operations and microservices especially, troubleshooting is one of those key kind of, you know, features of a good hire that can be really challenging. And if you're a good troubleshooter, you can solve a lot of problems. Or if you can ask the right questions, you can solve a lot of problems. So much of what we do is just asking questions, right? Going to Google, going to Stack Overflow, hunting and searching, looking at log files, or just asking the team, like, how does this work? How does that work? And so if you can find those people who really are intellectually curious, I think it's really important. So I hate whiteboard interviews. How many people here have actually had to stand at a whiteboard and write pseudocode or something like that? I walked out of an interview. I was so just angered by the whole thing. But I was also angered because, and especially in this one interview, they were like, you know, it was an operations job. They had 10 servers, 10 servers on Amazon Web Services. And it was like an early stage company. And they were all a very large enterprise-y company. So they all were like the top best engineers, or so they thought. And so they were basically like putting me through, like, write me an algorithm that basically is like Spotify, like for, you know, recommendation engine. And I'm like, what? This makes no sense. And they're like, oh, forget about that. Like, you know, can you write me some Python that can like get a, you know, an AMI from Amazon? And I was like, well, you know, I told you I don't do Python stuff. And they're like, that's fine, just dive right in. And I'm like, what? This makes no sense. So I hate whiteboard things, so what if instead of a whiteboard, we create a small project that we can give to a candidate and have it be a very clearly defined project, most importantly, aligned with their role. So like a recommendation engine when for an ops hire makes no sense. Increasing levels of difficulty as well, but also time box it. I think that's really important. So here's what we did at a previous company. We just said, build me an API server. And it was for an ops role, but you might think, well, when do I ever have to build an API server in ops? Maybe not build one, but we definitely interact with APIs constantly in operations. I mean, we have Amazon Cloud APIs. Everything's an API nowadays. And literally all we said, and it was pretty detailed, but the real crux of this was to build me something that when I curl it, I get back a response. And the response being, what is the current time? That's it. There's nothing else. We told candidates not to spend more than 4 hours on this project. And now I can't stop them if they spend more time. That's really up to them. But we really try to, you know, try to keep it in that small, short window. So the one thing I haven't solved in this, and it's my one gripe of this one, and if anyone is looking to do a startup or knows a startup that solves this problem, please let me know, is I want to be able to pay people to take this project. And paying people that don't work for you is super hard. There are, I mean, if you go to your CFO and said, hey, we're going to pay all these candidates every time we interview them to take this test, like, they're gonna lose their minds. There's tax implications, like, it just gets incredibly complex. So that's the only thing I think missing from this, is that I wanna pay them for their time to do this and really time box it. So we even added this escalating difficulty to it as well, because the first thing that we did when we created this project was for everyone on the team to take it. So everyone on the current ops team had to go do the same thing. And it was really interesting because, like, some people were like, you know, built a Sinatra app, deployed it to Heroku, took them 5 minutes. Some people just went through and like spun up an EC2 instance. I mean, they went all these different routes. But it was interesting to see how they kind of solved those problems. So then we added some additional things of like, oh, well, you know, add like a time zone conversion that you could pass in some data or deploy it somewhere or even add SSL support just to see kind of how far they could take it. Now, this wasn't a binary thing. If you just didn't get anywhere with it, it didn't mean anything for us. We wanted to see where you went with this. But in one case, we had an engineer who actually didn't deliver any code at all, but delivered 10 pages of documentation of the entire process of, well, what kind of web server would I use? And what kind of, like, how would I deploy it? Would I use Chef? And here's this. And it was just, like, the most amazing documentation I've ever seen. We hired that person in, like, 2 seconds. And you show that ability to have that level of detail, that was a winning hire. And that scenario where it's like, you know, you can't checkbox hire like great writing skills. Like, you can put it on there, but unless you actually see their writing skills, you actually don't know. So, but I think, again, at the end of the day, keeping people, I think, really starts with hiring the right people for the role. And I totally missed this last time. So Now, like last time, I said losing people sucks. And it's still the worst. I mean, it absolutely is terrible. And it cuts deep when it is avoidable and when it happens out of nowhere or seemingly out of nowhere. So why do we lose people in the first place? Well, I talked about last time, there's this book by Dan Pink, it's called Drive. I recommended it before, I still recommend it now. And he lists off kind of the three things about what drive us: autonomy, mastery, and purpose. And these are kind of like these key things that can help drive us and keep us motivated in our job. So I had this slide before, which was, you know, I tell my daughter what to do, not my engineers. And this was actually one of the things I kind of bumped on. I said, wait a second, that just sounds weird. I don't just let them kind of go off and do anything. And what I realized was back then I had these engineers who were very senior engineers. They were far more technically advanced than I was. And I actually had to leverage their technology expertise to help us like build a solution. And so, and I was very lucky to have that team. As time moved on, though, senior engineers are a lot harder to come by. I started hiring more junior engineers because leveling junior engineers up is a great way to build a team. And so then it turned out that I was the one that had the most technical experience. And so, you know, this turned into more of a, well, it's not really just telling them what to do. We still have that conversation. And I like to give people ownership over a project, but really try to let them run with it and do these little course corrections all the way. And the course correcting is helpful because you could have engineers that just say, you know, they go down kind of on this little boondoggle on the side, and you're like, whoa, 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 hold on a second. Like, what? Let's come back to center again. So now, of course, like things that age, so did my daughter. So I actually said we had to recreate this picture. It's a different laptop. I didn't just add 6 years worth of stickers to that laptop. It's a totally different laptop, which is actually probably worse because it's a brand new laptop and a ton of stickers. But so I tried to get her to do her like serious computering face here, but she was actually looking at a picture of herself when she was a baby doing this, and she just couldn't stop laughing. And I just went with it because, let's be honest, this was like the first time she did something that I asked her to do, so like, sold. So then how do you get work done in the grand scheme of things? You know, this is something I had mentioned before, which was, if you're not kind of, you know, forcing people down direction, you know, how do you get work completed? I still fully believe this, like align work with an owner, you know, giving people projects that are correct for their role that they can have impact on. But the biggest one here, back off and just let them work. As a manager, you know, the term I usually like to call it is like you're a shit filter, right, or a shit umbrella. But also you have to realize as a manager, you are a source of distraction as well. The best managers, jokingly, I've ever had are the ones who send me, and now in modern time, they send me a Slack, and then they walk over and say, hey, did you get that Slack I sent you? It's like, yes, my phone buzzed, my laptop beeped, and you walked over. So seagull management, it's not a thing that works. It's a great way to piss off your employees. Don't just kind of fly in, crap all over everything, and then leave. Give them something, back off, let them roll with it, and filter distractions as you can. So mastery is getting better at something that matters, and matters is really what matters to you. We talk about continuous deployment, continuous integration. Does your company do continuous learning? Do you have a learning budget? You know, there's so many great online sites for helping people learn more about what they're doing. Make sure that's in your budget. If it's not in your budget, get a budget for it. It's a silver bullet in many ways to level up your engineers. And there's just so many different vehicles to consume this stuff right now. It's amazing. If you put any of your engineers have interest in management, get them management training too. You don't just figure out management training. I mean, you can, but you'll burn through people until you do figure that out. Management training is incredibly valuable, and no one really invests in it. It's really sad. So then purpose too, right? Fulfilling work, something that matters, and this concept of I write code and it gets used somewhere. The worst thing ever is when you go down this project and at the last minute they're like, the whole project's been canceled, throw all that stuff away, because at the end of the day, like, people aren't saying this, right? Like, I want to write code that no one's ever going to use. The only servers I like are the ones that aren't running. Like, as painful as it is to get paged at 2 a.m. for bad code, I have worked at companies that no one bought your product, and that is 100 times worse. And so having that ability to take projects all the way through is a big part of it. So I talked before about open source projects. You know, this actually has changed. I think 6 or so years ago, open source projects were a great way to get your company known and out there, recruit new employees. And a good example of that is, how many people have heard of this tool Sensu? Good number of people. Anyone heard of a company called Sonian? Yeah, no one's heard of it. Oh yeah, one person. So I worked at a company called Sonian, and my team, we built Sensu to solve an internal problem we had. Now, granted, we were like, oh, it's going to be great. We'll have all these people come and work for us because they have this awesome open source thing. And then people were like, well, what do you do at Sonian? And we're like, we're an email archiving platform. And they were like, ugh, that sounds terrible. So, you know, I think nowadays, though, everyone does open source. It's kind of table stakes. It is a great way to get your name out there, and you should definitely do it. It does make people happy. I feel happy to contribute to open source, and so it's something that you want to you know, really help your engineers do. So remote people, I just hijacked this slide directly from my old deck because I think it's still spot on. I think hiring people is even harder than it was then, and the tools are so much better to work remote and have it. So at the end, it should not matter where people are contributing from. I do understand hiring remote is hard. It's a challenge to manage a remote people, and if your team's not 100% remote, it's even more of a challenge, but there's a lot of value there, and you can access a group of engineers that just don't exist for you in your city or in your office location. So again, some things didn't age too well. I had this slide listing off all of the different, you know, ways you can communicate with your team, right? Like Slack, you know, not Slack, sorry, Skype, HipChat, Google Meet or Google Hangouts, which is now dead. So they're all gone now for the most part. I know IRC is still around. Don't get angry with me about this. But unless you can turn on an entire company on IRC with a mobile app, and that includes your salespeople and your CEO, doesn't work. And really, let's be honest here, Slack has taken over the world, so. So we gotta talk about money, because that is a critical part of this. I mean, we work for money to, you know, have ourselves be able to, you know, pay for our lives. So there's a line that I've heard, and luckily I haven't heard it too much anymore, but everyone takes a pay cut to be here. You know, heard that one before. No, ever, never, ever, ever. Ever say this. If you hear someone say this, run as fast as you can. It's a terrible way of doing business, but the biggest reason why this is bad to do is because, especially in this market, you'll always have companies who will overpay, guaranteed. You'll have companies who pay market. If you're under market, like you hire an engineer at $80,000 and market's $100,000, and there's a company that will happily pay $120,000 because they need people that badly, who would not leave for a $40,000 pay bump? Almost everyone would. You're creating this delta that makes all of your employees poachable. It's insane. So you have to pay enough to take that issue off the table. I could look at a list of salaries of employees at a startup, and I could tell you how long those employees have been there based on their salaries. And that's another big thing, too. You need to go back and improve the salaries of your old employees. Every time you bring a new engineer on, now you know what the market rate is, and that's really important. And if you're having a hard time convincing your company to do that, all you have to say is that these are all poachable employees. I had one manager be like, wait a second, why didn't HR tell us that we were so far off on our salaries? He was livid. I was too. So there's this ratio that's important as a consumer of the money. It's the shit to pay ratio. Always do remember there will always be a company to pay you more in your role. But you do have to ask yourself, you know, do I want to deal with this shit? Is the pay enough for it? I think it's a good ratio to know. So at the end, underpay engineers at your own risk. This was mentioned before 6 years ago. It's bigger now. Oh, well, your startup, you have stock options. Neat. Okay, so we're going to do a quick primer on stock options here. I could spend an hour talking about stock options. And maybe we'll do an open space on it because I'd love to share Painter on that. So first off, you have stock options. Great. Are you a founder? If you're not a founder, that's probably not going to go anywhere. If you were a founder too, you probably bought those shares for like fractions of a penny. And those have real value. Okay, so you're not a founder. Were you granted restricted stock? Was that stock grant in the pennies also? Because when you buy the stock or are granted the stock, that is a taxable event. If you buy it, it's not. I don't know how many people want to start their job by like, you know, cutting a check to their company. So does that grant have protections for change and control? Does it have protections for like, let's say you're a product person and a new CEO comes in, how likely do you think your job is gonna be safe if this new CEO wants to bring in a new product person? You know, so you gotta make sure, because otherwise you could lose all those shares that you you know, expect to be getting. Has the company raised money? Is there a convertible note? There's all these different ways that your stock grant could be diluted massively, and it puts it at a massive risk. And then there's this secret of startups called liquidation preference on shares. It's called a different terms, participating preference, a lot of different things. What this basically means is if I put in money in as a buyer of your shares, like $10 million in, I might say, well, I need a multiple on this that is going to come off the top on the course of an exit. And so I'm going to take my $10 million out, and then we're going to split whatever's left over. And what it definitely means is there's countless examples of early stage common shareholders, which are all of us, getting screwed over at these early stage companies. So I always like to say that there's a lot of reasons why you won't get rich at a startup. That's not why you go to work at a startup. There's a lot of other good reasons. But there's chances to make money in other ways that I think is important too. Now, if you're at a big public company and you've got like RSUs that are granted, literally none of this applies. RSUs are real money. It's a stock. You can sell it when it vests. Get a financial advisor. I'm not one. I've just seen a lot of crazy things happen. So, all right. So we've done all that. We've done everything, right? And someone left anyway. Congratulate them. Ask them for feedback. Actually, ask them for the feedback. Accept that feedback because it may be hard to hear. And then wish them the best in their new role. And that's it. The way you treat people on their way out, everyone's going to hear about it. And if you treat people poorly, you're going to have an even harder time keeping new people on. One of the most important things I will point here, not only do I, and this is again a personal thing, I would never try to counteroffer you. If you say, hey, I'm leaving, first off, I should know that conversation should have been escalating over time. But also as a consumer of that, don't accept a counteroffer. I've never seen one of those happen in any sort of good way. If you're right, if it's time to go, it's time to go. And I think that's fine for everyone. So at the end of the day, though, people excel when they're excited about their work, when there's this high levels of trust across the organization, when your manager trusts you to get work done. They have ownership and responsibility over what they're doing. They can actually affect change. And so it really comes down to these three simple things here, right? That meaningful work, that people feel like they're making an impact, having that ownership over it, and having that trust. I mean, that's just such a huge part of companies and managers that when your trust is broken, it can completely demolish your relationship. So it's kind of easy because if you remember, these are all adults. These are real people, real adults here. If you treat them like adults, you may actually find out that you have this competitive advantage that you have people who want to work with you and want to work for you. So they're highly paid professionals. You got to treat them as such. That's all I have today. Really appreciate having me out. Thank you very much.
Questions or if anybody has any questions for Pete?
Yeah, I got two questions. What luck have I had? The 4-hour thing. So I have not had much luck because I've had a hard time. Sorry. So the question was, what luck have I had paying people to do like a 4-hour project? My honest truth is I really have not had much luck on it. I mean, I've played around with the idea of like gift cards, but like that's a money thing and just cutting them a check. And the financial, I maybe need a newer, better CFO or something that I could talk to about that. If anyone here actually, does that at their company, I would be curious about how they do, how they handle that. Yeah. No, I'd love to do it. Yeah.
Oh, so they have a whole platform. What was the name of the company? ODEC? Yeah. Oh, gotcha. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I think at the end of the day, it's not even the money. I mean, I would easily pay hundreds of dollars for someone to take that. I mean, people's time is valuable. I think it's there's something that a lot of companies just need to kind of mentally get over of like, no, this is the new normal now. I guess I just need to keep working to convince it. But hey, if anyone's looking for a good startup idea, that would be a killer startup. I would invest in that in a heartbeat. So. So I haven't done any, so the question was around, you know, retaining the long-term contractors. So I actually haven't had done any out of country, just based on the companies I've worked for. But long-term internal contractors, interestingly enough, I incorporate that in them, the contractors into the business just like they're a normal employee, basically. You know, they're in the chat systems, they're in the weekly one-on-ones and things like that. And it kind of sounds simple, but I've definitely seen places fall down on that is, you know, they're an employee. They may be a contractor, but they're an employee. So they should be part of, you know, all of the same things you're doing, all of the same meetings and everything else, instead of just kind of being pulled in last minute to be like, go and do the thing, you know. So, awesome. Any other questions? Yes. Okay. So yeah, it sounds like gift cards might be a way, yeah. I was thinking that was the case, like, you know, hey, do this thing, and also, by the way, thanks for, you know, coming in, and here's, like, an Amazon, like, credit, two separate transactions or something.
I disagree with you on making counteroffers. The market is moving so fast that if somebody comes to me and says, hey, I'm making 90, I have this offer letter for 110, if I want to retain them, I'm going to counter them at 115 if I can make it happen, because they're valuable to me. They should be looking.
Coming to me, they're offering me this amount, you know, I want to stay here, right? And that's kind of maybe the difference, I guess, in that, which is, I mean, I've had people be like, I'm leaving for this new job, and then I always kind of think of that as like the true, like, I'm leaving, but I think you should use that information absolutely to help get paid, so. At the one-on-one, yeah, and that's a big one too, which is, yeah. And I think as a manager, you know, being competitive on pay, especially for startups, because startups are honestly the worst at this, is as your engineers are there longer, like, again, guaranteed, those early ones are underpaid. You'll hire a new one, like, you need to go back and fix it. And you'll probably do it, like, out of cycle and all that other stuff like that as well. So, yeah. 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 So two parts. One is to do an open space, which I would love to do an open space to talk about salaries and stuff, because then you can talk about like stock too. Because if you've ever had like an offer including stock, there are questions you should ask about that. And then the second part of that one, totally agree, right? I think I really want my engineers. Like, I see there's nothing wrong having my engineers. If I hear they're interviewing somewhere, that doesn't anger me. I think you should always know what your worth is. I think interviewing is good for that, and getting that knowledge to then I think use that information just to be like, listen, hey, this is the market and this is what's paying. And honestly, I would say, and again, nothing wrong with going to a company and being like, listen, I'm going to definitely go to this thing because, like, you guys are dragging your feet, and this is a lot more money, and, you know, and they might be like, hey, actually, we'll give you more, and then, cool, or they just might be like, you know, hey, not going to work, so companies are weird. Yeah. Yeah, so the statement was the stats around 90% of people who accept a counteroffer leave in 6 months. I've heard similar stats around that. I've had previous companies where I've just seen it. There's this kind of mental model that's like, even if you get the counteroffer, I can't explain it entirely, but you get the counteroffer, let's say it's 15,000 more, maybe the best I can do is five because I have this budget to fit inside of. And maybe that makes you happy, but it's like, I don't know, there's this mental model I feel like happens in people where they're like, oh, like I'm leaving this money on the table. I would feel that way. Oh, interesting. Gotcha. All right, I'm getting waved off here. Gotta play me out. Awesome. Anyway, thanks.